Hello everyone, and today we are going to discuss the following topics, that is single stage amplifier overview, then why amplifiers, and we'll also see the difference between ideal versus non-ideal amplifier. Fine, so let us continue. So let us overview single stage amplifier. What are we going to cover in this next 5 to 10 lectures? So first we'll start with why amplifiers, then we'll differentiate between ideal and non-ideal amplifier, then we have already seen amplifier trade-off in the form of analog octagon, right? And then the following amplifiers will be covered. In common source amplifier, you must have already studied common source amplifier, common drain amplifier, and common gate amplifier in your lower semester subject. Those amplifiers were keeping in mind discrete circuits. Like for example, you have lot of resistors, but these are single stage integrated circuit amplifiers, which carries almost none, almost no resistors with it, right? So in common source amplifier, we will be discussing common source amplifier with resistive load, diode connected load, current source load, triode load, and source degeneration. In fact, this single stage amplifier topic weightage is very much higher. And next we'll study the common drain amplifier, more famously known as source follower. Okay, so we'll analyze it and we'll solve some numericals based on it. And then comes the common gate amplifier. So under single stage amplifier, you already have a background of all this, but the biasing which we'll be using is something other than resistors. Now in overall, single stage amplifiers, I mean in this module, that is 2.1, we have started with module 2.1, that is single stage integrated circuit amplifiers. For every amplifier, we will do the following analysis, which is given over here in different color. Small signal operation, right? We will find its small signal voltage gain. Large signal operation. Now, in the end of today's session, we will discuss. You all will be understanding what do you mean by large signal operation. Then the small signal model. Obviously, we are going to draw a small signal model for every circuit which we have just now discussed about. Then we will estimate the small signal voltage gain, input impedance and output impedance, which are of prime importance to an amplifier. Fine. So for all the single stage amplifiers, in fact, for cascode amplifier also, we will be following this approach. Then finally, we will be discussing cascode amplifiers, and in that we will study, double cascode, triple cascode, and also folded cascode. So this module is very important from the marks point of view and from the weightage point of view also. Now, let us start. Yeah. So actually this amplifier requirements, I'm repeating again, we have discussed this before. So for an amplifier, especially for a voltage amplifier, there are these four requirements which should be satisfied. First of all, it should have some gain, right? So voltage gain should be, as high as possible. Input impedance from a voltage amplifier perspective should be very, very high. Output impedance again from the voltage amplifier perspective should be very, very low. So if any amplifier is providing such thing, that means it's a very ideal amplifier, but no one amplifier will provide everything, right? But the most important thing is the linearity, right? If you, there is a reason why you apply a very small signal, and that reason was very much cleared in, one or two sessions before. So linearity should be extremely important, right? If your amplifiers are not linear, whatsoever input you give, output will be distorted. So these are the four primary importance of requirements of an amplifier. So these are the points which we have already discussed, but I would like to repeat again. It's a fact that a MOSFET is a voltage dependent current source because it will convert a voltage to a current. Now this property of MOSFET, we will be going to use it, and that property is very useful in, when it is used as an amplifier. So we have discussed about this point key, how the MOSFET amplifier can be linear. I'll just explain in a brief, okay, in a minute. I mean revising these things, fine? So what happens is we just superimpose a microphone signal with a DC bias. Why DC bias is required in the form of VGG? so that my MOSFET operates in the saturation region. Now, once MOSFET operates in the saturation region, it is eligible to behave as an amplifier. Our final goal is that MOSFET should behave as an amplifier. So for that, our input which we applied, microphone signal, as you know, peak-to-peak input is in millivolts, right? So why there is a requirement ki input should be so small? The input should be so small, the reason being is that in the transfer curve, if you draw a tangent, there will be a small section which is linear. And your input should be confined within this section. This, I mean, if I can say it more thoroughly, within this green section, it's the input should be confined. If it is beyond this point, then output may you will get a distortion. Now, how MOSFET converts conveniently a voltage to a current? Correct? MOSFET converts your voltage at the input to a drain current at the output. And that drain current, when it flows through a resistor, it again converts the current into a voltage. Right? That's how it actually the entire circuit over here, which you see, it's a voltage to voltage converter. Right? It's taking voltage in and it's providing voltage out. Okay. So this point was already clear. I don't want to discuss it anymore. Yeah. The point of being why we study amplifiers and why they are very important in analog domain, right? Amplifiers are the very first essential blocks of both analog as well as digital systems. It's not that we don't require amplifiers in digital systems, but their requirement, their biasing conditions, everything is different. Now, amplifiers are needed for a variety of reasons, including to amplify a weak analog signal. Now, all the naturally occurring signals are analog in nature, right? You do the further processing. You convert analog signal into digital signal, but you convert a strong analog signal into a digital signal, not a weak analog signal, right? Because it will be just a noise. So that's why before converting your analog to digital, you want to amplify it. Right? So that's the requirement to amplify. Next requirement of why we use study amplifiers is because to reduce the effect of noise of the next stage, right? Because this amplifiers will be connected to something else. Might be it's connected to a speaker, might be it's connected to an antenna. It has to be connected to something, right? So why we study amplifiers is to reduce the effect of noise of the next stage. Lastly, to provide a proper logical levels in digital circuits, right? Now you must have studied, inverter. Inverter like a MOS inverter, MOSFET in MOSFET as an inverter, you must have studied, right? NMOS inverter, then CMOS inverter. Now what are all those things? The same circuits can behave as an amplifier also. It's just the region of operation we are worried about, right? So we will talk about that point a little later, but this point number C, I will be elaborating it in more details in one of the examples coming ahead, right? So these are why we require amplifiers. It also plays a crucial role in the feedback systems. Now, you know, there are various feedback topologies, right? And in all those feedback topologies, we require amplifier of some form of the other. Today, in this module, we are going to discuss only voltage amplifiers. But in case of feedback systems, we also have transconductance amplifier, transimpedance amplifier, current amplifiers, correct? But right now our focus is that we will be focusing only on the voltage amplifier, where input is a voltage and output is a voltage. And also we will look at the low frequency behavior of single stage amplifier right now. So for low frequency behavior, all the external capacitors in the small signal model are ignored, right? So this is the assumption we'll be using for all of the amplifiers which we'll be studying in the module number 2.1. And then we will analyze closely what's the difference between a large signal and a small signal characteristics of each circuit, or we can say each amplifier circuit. So, why we go for only low frequency, this develops an technique or intuitive technique and model that prove useful in understanding more complex circuit. You don't start directly with a very complex circuit, right? Include the frequency response, include everything, and then you build on that. No. First, we will slowly build up on the topics, and then in the module number 2.2, we go for the frequency response. And then again, a very important topic comes, the ideal versus the non-ideal amplifier. We would love that our amplifier should be ideal, but naturally the devices which are used, active devices which are used to build amplifiers, are not linear. MOSFET is a non-linear device. A BJT is a non-linear device. Those are active devices, right? Resistors are linear, but we cannot use them. In fact, we use MOSFET as resistors, right? And they are again non-linear. So what's the basic definition of an ideal amplifier and a non-ideal amplifier? We are going to discuss in the next 2 minutes. Okay. So this is, figure number A is my plot of x-axis and y-axis, wherein my, x is my input and y is my output with respect to time. And this is kind of a linear relation between them. The slope of that is beta 1. And the bias point, we can say the y coordinate is beta 0. So we can express conveniently y of t is equal to, we can say y of t is proportional to x of t, where beta 1 will be the slope, correct? Where, beta 0 is just the bias point. Now, large signal amplifier characteristics is a straight line. So this is a large signal characteristics of an amplifier. Ideally, it can be, right? But ideally, there is no amplifier existing. We are using a non-linear devices. So let's just discuss about it a little more. So when we say y of t is the output and x of t is the input, when we are building an amplifier, that means my beta 1 has to be gain, voltage gain in this matter, correct? So your beta 1 is the gain and my beta 0 is the DC bias, correct? Why DC bias? Because in an amplifier, you bias the transistor, bias the MOSFET. For biasing the MOSFET, you have to apply a biasing voltage. That means to an amplifier, you are feeding an AC signal as well as a DC bias. So you have both AC and DC. So that's why beta 0 is the DC bias. So here, from this characteristics, there is no doubt that output, which is y of t, is a linear function of the input, which is x of t. Okay, so this is the characteristics of an ideal amplifier. We want, all the amplifiers to behave like this, but in reality, it doesn't happen. So let's discuss what happens in the real world. That is a non-ideal amplifier, right? So that equation which we have written, y of t is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x of t, cannot be, describing this behavior. So here we have to use the Taylor series and expand the terms. We have a higher order terms also, right? Now here your x can be a current or a voltage, correct? Y can be a current or a voltage, fine? So in real world, the input-output characteristics is typically a non-linear function. Now this figure number B is just an example. It can be other way around. It can be any way. It's highly unpredictable how the response will be between the, the input and the output, right? So here we say that, x is between x1 and x2. That is the bias point. So between x1 and x2, we can predict the system. It's all about predicting the system, right? If my amplifier predicts ki at this input, I will get that output, that is what this linearity means, right? So let's just consider this small segment, x1 and x2. Between x1 and x2, my output is predictable, right? So this varying gain, because as you see, the gain of the amplifier is a function of input, which it should not be, right? The gain of the amplifier, should be set by the circuit components and not the input. So this varying gain is approximated by a polynomial, right? So either you bias it at one of the points, x1, or you bias it at x2, or you bias in between them, right? Okay, you make a tangent of that. So let's just consider this. So if you operate your amplifier for this entire range of input, that then it will cause a distortion, right? That's what is written over here. So what you do is you draw a tangent to this curve at a given operating point. You know that DC bias, okay? X is my input, right? You know you are applying a DC input. So you know your DC bias, right? So just deviate from there, small, up and down, right? So what we are doing is, this is a non-linear curve. This dark pink color curve is my non-linear curve. And my green color is my tangent. So you are linearizing a non-linear function. When you are linearizing a non-linear function, you are linearizing it at a given operating point over here. And this is my operating point, correct? So your y of t, here we are writing, it is an attempt to make this function a linearized function. Or else, you will all get distortion at the output of an amplifier, which is not acceptable. Maybe it is amplifying, but what's the use if the positive half of the negative half or both the halves are clipped? No use of it, right? So what do we do is Y of t is approximated or designed in such a manner that if input is very, very small, then only my input and output will be linear function of each other. So this beta 0 is my bias point and my beta 1 is my small signal voltage. I mean, gain. We are saying general term gains because we haven't defined whether Y or X are voltages or currents or a voltage or a current. Okay. So what is the conclusion? As long as beta 1 into X of t is very, very small as compared to the bias point. Let's say that bias point is 2 volt. Okay. And the input which you are applying is, let's say, 10 millivolt. So your 10 millivolt, which is, you know, input small X of t, which is very, very small, and you have a small signal gain, let's say gain of 5. So that 10 into 50 becomes, 10 millivolts into 5 of gain becomes 50 millivolt. So that 50 millivolts is very, very small compared to beta 0. Then your bias point is disturbed negligibly. Okay. And if your biasing point, if your beta 1 into X of t is very much comparable to my biasing point, what will happen? The larger the signal changes about the operating point, the worse the approximation of the curve becomes. So the more and more higher input signal which you choose, so that approximation will become more and more worse and you will get a more and more distortion in the output signal. That means you're moving towards the non-linearity again. So what is the learning from here? The learning is that if you wish your amplifier to be linear, you have to, you know, operate it such a way that the inputs are within the linear version, linear approximation of your input-output characteristics. Okay, so that is the conclusion over here. Anyone having any doubt in this? The difference between non-linear amplifier and the linear amplifier, it's very clear. We will be actually the very fact that we study the small signal model, the very moment you draw the small signal model, we are linearizing the MOSFET actually, because you are not drawing its symbol. You are representing that between the gate and source, we have open circuit. Between the drain and source, we have a current source. That's a linear version of it, right? Yeah. So this is about the non-linearity. It should be minimum in an amplifier. So let's move on to the next point. Now, this is very, very important. Building up the concept of an amplifier. So let's say we want to build an amplifier, correct? So listen very carefully. It's very interesting. So let's say we have a microphone, right? So microphone signal act as a time-varying AC. So one will speak into the microphone, right? So what will happen is we are building a voltage-dependent current source. So how do you represent a voltage-dependent current source? We have over here input V of X, which we call it as a mic signal, microphone signal. That microphone signal is Vm sin omega t. So it's a sinusoidal signal having a peak-to-peak value of 2 Vm. Okay, and this microphone signal will generate a time-varying signal. Fine, it's naturally analog. And we are saying that if we build a voltage-dependent current source, this input V of X might be amplified form at V out. And how we do that? We are building up a voltage-dependent current source over here. So what will happen? Microphone signal will change Vx. Vx will generate a current K times Vx, where K is a factor, greater than 1. And then this current flows through the resistor. Whenever the current flows through the resistor, it causes a voltage drop V out. So we are saying that if a microphone signal Vx changes, my output changes, and that is an amplified voice. That is what we want, right? So this is ideally what we want. Our input voltage changes, converted into a current, and that current flows to a resistor, producing the output voltage, correct? So let's make our first attempt to make an amplifier. So what do we do is, we know that a MOSFET behaves as a voltage-dependent current source. Okay, so we have connected a MOSFET. Fine. So between the gate and source terminal, we have connected the microphone signal, and between the drain and source, we have connected RL. So will this circuit work as an amplifier? What's the answer in this? why it will not work as an amplifier? Anyone? We have used MOSFET and we have done all which has been done in the standard form. But why this circuit over here to your right hand side of your screen will not work as an amplifier? The answer is written over there. It's not an amplifier because in absence of your mic signal, that means mic signal will be, let's say, varying between 10 millivolt to 20 millivolt. I mean, sorry, 10 millivolt to minus 10 millivolt. Okay, so such a small voltage will not drive the, you know, your MOSFET to turn on. So in the absence of your signal, let's forget about that. In absence of your signal, this VGS is zero, right? So whenever VGS is zero, this M1 is only off. So what amplification it will do? So this circuit is not an amplifier. Fine. So next, what we did was we have added a biasing voltage V1. Okay? We have added a biasing voltage such that your VGS, your V1 is greater than VTH. So that means even if the, even in the absence of a signal, even in the absence of the signal, that is the mic signal is zero, your VGS is equal to V1. And V1 is greater than the threshold voltage of the transistor. So my M1 is on. Now, if my M1 is on, will this work as an amplifier? Will the current flow? No, there will be no current in the drain source loop because there is a no source of energy, correct? Your MOSFET requires a current, I mean, requires a source to power on, right? Your VDD is missing. Okay, so your amplifier is, the circuit is eligible to amplify, but not without the DC supply. So it has no source of energy. There will be no amplification. So still this circuit over here, which you see on your screens, does not work as an amplifier. So let's proceed further. So let's say we have connected a DC supply. Okay. So we have connected over here VDD. Let me bring it over here so that it's in the center. Yeah. So now, will this circuit work as an amplifier? Well, let's find out. Correct. So we have applied a microphone signal. We have superimposed a DC bias, which will make sure that M1 is operating in the saturation region. Correct. So in the even in the absence of signal, the MOSFET M1 is on. So now the current will flow in the circuit, right? Output loop because of the VDD. So there will be a current ID flowing through the resistor. And whenever the current flows through the resistor, there will be a voltage drop, VRL. Whenever current flows through the resistor, there will be a voltage drop across the resistor. So here in this circuit, the current flows in the drain to source loop. That means the current flows through RL, which causes a voltage drop VRL. Correct? So what will happen? In the presence of microphone signal, what will happen over here? This we are talking about in the absence of microphone signal. So what will happen in the presence of microphone signal? Anyone? In the presence of microphone signal, this voltage will be added to V1. That means VGS will change. That means my current ID will change. And if the current ID changes, my Vout will change. That is the whole, you know, crux of an amplifier, right? So that is what has been written over here. Let me just broaden and show it to you what's been written. So in an presence of a microphone signal, your VGS value will begin to change, ID will change, and my Vout will change. That's how we are hoping to build an amplifier. Okay. Now there is one more concept here. Fine. So let me draw I have drawn over here the time varying signal, because amplifier means V in has to be with respect to time, and V out also has to be respect to time. We are not measuring DC quantities, but DC quantities are required. So this is my VGS voltage. I told you VGS voltage is a combination of input AC. There is a microphone signal, which is Vm sin omega t, marked in black color over here, and a bias point. I mean, V1 is my constant value. So V1 is DC voltage. Plus, we are superimposing the AC over it. Okay. So this is my VGS with respect to time. Fine. Now, what will be my VRL? Now, anyone can tell me what is VRL? What is my value of VRL? What is the voltage across RL resistor? Hello? So voltage across the resistor will be current flowing through the resistor into resistance itself. So VRL is what? ID into RL. Correct? So this ID into RL also will have a DC bias. But along with it, it will be slightly amplified form. Because why? Because if VGS changes by small amount, your ID also changes. But that ID you're multiplying with RL with a constant value. So there will be some fluctuations in the output, which we call it as an amplification. But are we measuring the output voltage with respect to, you know, VRL? No. We are taking the output voltage at the drain terminal. You're in this case. So how will my output voltage look like? Where will be the DC level? What will be the DC level for the output voltage? Now, come on, you all tell me the answer of this. So the question is, what will be the DC level of Vout? I put a question mark over here. What will be the DC level of Vout from the circuit? Hello? Yeah, come on, try. What will be the DC value of Vout? Because Vout is plus DC, right? So you should know at least the DC level of Vout. Think. I'll wait for 5 more seconds. Okay. So if you apply a KVL, if we apply the KVL to the drain source loop, what do we get? VDD minus ID into RL minus VDS is equal to zero. And what is VDS over here? Vout. So what will be your this thing? VRL plus Vout is equal to VDD. So what will be Vout? Vout is nothing but VDD minus IDRL. So that is what is the DC level of the output voltage. Correct? So that's how, I mean, this is the amplification part. We are not, we should be interested in the DC level as well as the amplification over here. So that is what the DC level of my output is, VDD minus IDRL. So let us summarize what we have done, and we have a first common source amplifier. Now, why we call it as a common source amplifier? Because input is applied to the gate terminal and the output is sensed at the drain terminal. Okay. It's not because the source terminal is common between the input and output. That may be one of the reasons, right? But it is not always true. In the DC circuit point of view, basically. In the AC circuit, that particular terminal will be common for sure. So in fact, it is a coincidence that the source terminal is common both in the AC as well as DC in this case. That's why many people say that because the source is common between the input and output, that's why it's called as a common source amplifier. No, that's not the reason. Because the input is applied to the gate and the output is sensed at the drain terminal. That's why it's called as a common source amplifier. Fine. So this is an amplifier. So we have built a first amplifier and it's called as a common source amplifier. Fine. Forget about why it is. We will be discussing it in detail. Why it is coming out of phase and all that. Everything will be clear to you. In one step, I can explain why it is coming out of phase. So if my input increases, my VGS increases. Correct? If my VGS increases, you have the drain current formula, right? If your VGS increases, your current ID will increase. And if your current ID increases, see over here in the DC level. If your current ID increases, what will happen to this DC level? It will fall down. And hence you have your, the entire voltage over here also will be inverted. As the input will increase, the output will actually decrease. So that's the reason. Okay. Any questions over here? I'll keep the screen for. So we have considered various cases and we have finally decided that this circuit will behave, might behave as an amplifier with a MOSFET. With input signal, normally this microphone signal, we show it as a current source, voltage source. And a resistive load is connected over here, RL load. RL is the load. And we require also the DC supply, power supply, VDD. Along with the bias voltage, V1. to bias the MOSFET in the proper region of operation. Okay, so this is the concept of building an amplifier, and we have seen that this circuit behaves as an amplifier and is called as a common source amplifier. Any doubt, anyone in this? Anyone having any doubt?